Hello, I'm Steven Sachs, owner of Solutions to Results, a consultancy that helps professional service firms and organizations in the areas of communication, culture, education, and training. Joining me today is Judy Trepeck, Managing Director of the Trepeck Group, which provides consulting and education to the CPA community. Judy previously played critical roles in the AI CPA in both domestic and international matters, and was also a state and local tax judge for the state of Michigan. Today, we're with Dom Cingoranelli, recent past executive vice president and co-founder of the Succession Institute that specializes in consulting management on matters relating to succession, performance management, and organizational development, both within and outside the accounting profession. Thank you, Dom, for joining us today.
Steve, thank you for letting me join. Steve and Judy, I appreciate the opportunity to be with you this afternoon.
That's great. You know, Dom, firms talk about how their employees are the most important assets. Firm invests a lot of resources in training and development. However, when it comes to coaching to help in the areas of cultivating expertise in business development and international, or I should say interpersonal skills, the firms fall far short in their desired outcomes. So before we jump into today's discussion, the heart of discussion on coaching and mentoring, they're both terms being used interchangeably, but you have a different take. What are the main differences between coaching and mentoring?
Yeah, thanks, Steve. These terms are bandied about interchangeably, and they shouldn't be. Mentoring really describes a process where the agenda is driven by the protege, the person being mentored, rather than by the mentor. Typically, it's usually a less formal process. Usually, the discussions are ad hoc in nature. The mentor often comes from outside the area, outside of the group or the segment where the protege is working, and so it has some real benefits for firms that can afford it in terms of helping people get onboarded, helping people understand the culture of the firm, helping high potentials learn how to succeed within the firm as they go forward in the leadership ranks. But coaching is far different. Coaching really is something where the coach holds the protege accountable for performance to help the coach person, the protege, grow in their competencies, to help them get where they need to be in the firm. It usually requires the coach to have some fair amount of understanding of what that protege is doing. It's usually a more formal process. The discussions are driven by the coach, and there's accountability. The protege is held accountable for certain performance expectations set by the coach as well. So you can see between these two definitions, there's quite a big spread. And so when people start throwing these discussions, these terms around, we have to ask them, tell me more about what it is you expect this person to do in this role.
So do you think that coaching is being done properly in CPA firms today, regardless of their size?
Well, yes and no. There are more and more firms who are really taking seriously their investment in their people, who understand that for the long term, they need to develop that intellectual capital that's between the brains, up between the ears and the brains, and they realize that that's not going to happen just by itself. And so there are more and more firms are trying to do that, but some of them are still learning how to do it. They don't know what they don't know in some cases. Sometimes there are barriers to success, barriers in terms of lack of support from the top down, barriers in terms of focus on short-term performance metrics for everybody. Let's just get the billable hours in, bill it and collect it. And if you get time after you put in your 60 hours or whatever it is, see if you can coach that person over there to get them functional. And so those really create some issues for many firms because they're just not doing it right. You know, one time we called up, we were doing interviews for a firm to get ready to go in for some strategic planning. We learned that one of the partners was very, very awesome. She was like bionic in her coaching of people. So I talked with her and I said, hey, tell me about your coaching. How does that affect your pay? And she says, well, so far it hasn't hurt me yet. And so that's, unfortunately, that's the kind of culture that we run into all too often in the profession.
I talked to a large firm at one time that felt like they were having problems with their coaching process. And what I found was that the coaches, number one, didn't get any training to be a coach to somebody. And number two, looked at their own work and their own set of responsibilities. Well, heck, I got to get those done first before I can spend any time with Dom, you know. So by the time they're ready for Dom, it was 8:30 at night. And Dom's a young guy with his family and, you know, trying to balance his life. And so the timing was all off. So I saw that there just wasn't the training that a coach really needs to be effective.
Well, not only that, not only a lack of training, but there's also a lack of understanding of performance management. And so the firms think that if they keep paying people for what they've always been doing, and then just say, hey, by the way, you need to coach some of these people and make them better, then it's going to happen. But if coaching those people doesn't figure into what is going to go into my paycheck, why do you think I'm going to do it? If you keep paying me to do something else, why do you think I'm going to do this? And so there's a combination of all of these factors that come together to create a perfect storm of incompetent or just non-existent coaching at times.
Or bad.
Yeah.
Bad coaching.
Fundamentally, aren't there certain types of skills that a coach must need? You know, presumably interpersonal skills and otherwise. Where do you find the gaps? What specifically is missing?
You know, that's another good question. When you think about what a coach does, you know, a coach has to help people understand their expectations, has to help set them up for success, has to assess where they need assistance and then find ways to provide that assistance and give them the on-the-job learning experience, formal and informal training. You can see that that's all pointing to some very key competencies. So, for instance, communication, like you said, interpersonal skills, communication. Does the coach know how to ask open-ended questions? Does the coach know how to actively listen? Can the coach monitor nonverbals? How self-aware is the coach? What sort of level of emotional intelligence does that person have that's being asked to coach? Not only that, how much do they understand when it comes to delegation, to the process of coaching in the firm, to what motivates people? How about, as you said, general interpersonal skills, including generating a following, developing a following so people want to have this person help them, people trust them. Can they engender trust? If I don't trust you, why would I think you're going to help me get better? If I'm used to getting snarled and snapped at, why would I think that you're going to make me a better professional? Not only that, but they need to have some sense, job competency regarding the area that we're being coached in as well. You know, if I'm in the tax side of the house, why would you expect me to be able to coach you to success if you're in the assurance services side?
Except that there's a perspective that somebody outside the team can give to, I'm presuming, a young person, you know. So, I mean, tax and I understand that, you know, because the competencies, you know, can be different. But sometimes it's hard, isn't it, to have a coach in that same you know, that same line as you're working, or somebody whose team you're sitting on?
Well, actually, that's the ideal situation, because that's the only way that coach is going to understand what you're doing, to help you get better at it and to hold you accountable at it, and for you to be able to go to them and say, I need some help here. And so what you've described, having somebody sit on the other side, that actually is what the mentors do, and they do a good job of it. For the firms in the small to medium-sized firms who have very limited budgets, we suggest go with the coach to begin with. If then you've got that working properly, then if you want to layer on another level of assistance, then put in the mentoring side over and above it like that.
How long do you think, or maybe how long is it typical, if we can say that, typical amount of time that somebody remains with the same coach? Like, is it a year, you know what I mean? Like a year or 18 months or, you know, before they should get a taste of somebody else, right?
Yeah, and that's going to vary, because there's so many different factors to consider. A small firm may not have the luxury of being able to get people multiple coaches. The other side of it, too, though, is that as you progress then you should be getting coached as you get to another position. You should be getting coached by somebody else in that new position as well. And so that can vary, 12 months, 18 months, something like that. Just kind of depends on what your circumstances are.
So if a firm decides that it needs coaching for whatever reason, how can someone, let's say the managing partner or the leadership group within the firm, immediately tell whether someone has the right aptitude and attitude to be an effective coach?
Well, you know, that's a great question, because when you look at this, you guys have got some wonderful questions here today. You know, again, right aptitude and attitude. Do they have a passion for developing and growing people, or do they have a passion for just cranking out work? Do they have a passion for sitting back, researching hairy technical things, or do they have a passion for helping other people learn how to research the hairy technical things? Do they have a sense of that, like we said before, this self-awareness, self-monitoring, the will? Do they have themselves a willingness to learn, a willingness to be open to learning new ways of doing things? Because part of what you're going to find is when you're dealing with people, everybody's a little different. So how do you approach somebody's particular needs within a framework, within a structure to help them be successful? So all of those kinds of things. And again, what sort of interpersonal skills do they bring? You know, we have all seen people in the firms where we've worked, in the organizations we've worked, or the organizations where, that we've helped. Just simply, if you would look at them and you'd ask their peers or the layer above them, who are the coaching potentials here? There's always one or two that just come right to mind. And then there's always one or two or more who just, everybody just says, no, that's not where we're going to get the highest and best use from those people, right? So that's kind of what we look at.
So so once you found the right person, has the right aptitude and attitude, and you've sort of pre-planned how you would like to approach this whole new era of coaching, let's talk a little bit about the coaching process. What does it typically entail?
Sure. You know, bottom line, is there to help somebody learn how to do their job. It's helping them connect the dots between their cognitive understanding of what this job should look like and the actual practical getting the job done. How do we actually get out there and make it happen? Sure, I've been trained in how to perform certain audit or review procedures. Great. What does that look like in this firm? How do I actually make that happen within the budgets and do a good QC job and all of that? I've been trained about some principles of corporate taxation. How do I actually apply those in either the planning work I'm going to do or the compliance work I'm going to do? So really, the coach's role, it involves helping them understand where their developmental needs are, getting the buy-in on it, holding up the mirror to them in that respect to say, here's kind of what we see, here's where we think we can really help you grow, and then looking for developmental assignments, the training, and so on, and providing that ongoing monitoring and feedback. And one of the areas where people really fall short in our profession, maybe more so than in others, but for sure in our profession, is knowing when and how much to monitor somebody. And so it's like a one size fits all. I go to you and I say, Steve, here, this tax return, this file, this project needs completed within 2 weeks, within a week, whatever it is. And I give it to you. And I say, you know, look at what we did last year. If you have any questions, come see me. And if that's the first time ever you've done that, what's that going to look like at the end of a week or two if I just walk away? And yet so many people make the mistake of doing that because they look and they say, well, look, he's got an accounting degree. He's got a master's degree. He's got this many years of experience. Heck, he even passed a CPA exam. He ought to know how to do this. Nobody held my hands when I was growing up in the profession. Why should I hold, right? You know, why should I hold their hands? And so they don't understand that we have to take a look at, has this person ever done this job before? Mm-hmm. This particular kind of work. How expert are they at doing it? And by the way, how comfortable are they with it? If they're a little insecure or a lot insecure, I'm going to need to spend a little more time with them to get them comfortable with it and help them be successful rather than just dumping them into the deep end of the swimming pool. And every time they come up for air and they just get over to grab that side of the swimming pool, I step on their fingers and I say, no, you're okay. You're okay. Just keep keep trying. You'll learn how to swim if you stay out there long enough. Just keep treading water. So
that's an interesting analogy. I didn't know there was such violence in the profession. So as a coach, what type of action plan would you create? How far out would you go? You know, what are some of the basic elements?
Well, this kind of goes back to Judy's question when she talks about, you know, how long do we spend with a coach if we're looking at having somebody and being able to work with them for a year or so. You know, really, we look at kind of a 30, 60, 90-day kind of approach. And so let's take a look at creating an immediate action plan based on some very, very reasonable kinds of steps that need to be put in place right away and see what that's going to do over the next weeks, next 30 days or so. And we continue to check in and see how we're doing. And we continue then to build on the success. One of the things we talk about in action planning is let's not take more than one or two areas at a time to focus on, because you may have 10 or 12 areas you need to work on, right? But let's focus on one or two or three or four and allow them to get some really good traction in those. And then we can add the next two or three in on top of that as we go forward. And so it's a matter of sitting down with the protege and talking about what it is we're going to work on, and then create a shared understanding by working with them to say, here's what I think the next steps would be, and here's how we're going to measure success, which I know you're going to want to talk about. But that's another thing. Many people will take somebody that don't know what they're doing and say, okay, here's where you need to fix things. You need to get better at this. I want you to come back to me in 2 days with an action plan. Look, most of the people that come to work for us are reasonable, bright, intelligent, motivated folks. Most of the time, if they knew how to do it, you wouldn't be having this discussion with them to begin with. That's why they need us to help create the action plans. In many cases, they're going to need a little bit more help just to kind of understand what that's going to look like step by step.
That's interesting, because we were going to talk about measuring success and what metrics that you put in place. You know, I've worked in public accounting, worked in associations, same with Judy. So we've seen a number of different environments. You know, what has evolved the most over the past 5, 10, 15 years in terms of measurements, or are there new metrics that are being employed?
I think the metrics totally depend on what you're trying to do. And so to the extent that people are getting an awareness that we need to leverage our work better, which, you know, is something that the Succession Institute has hounded people about for years, is partners need to leverage. They need to push work down. Mm-hmm. Managers need to take their work and push it down. It needs to get pushed down to the lowest level possible in all situations. So to the extent that people are finally looking and saying, okay, how do we leverage our work? Then there's metrics we need to create that we need to follow to say, so how much work have I pushed down? What level of work am I working at? And so what kinds of codes am I using to bill my work? How many billable hours on my work, if I'm a partner now, are being done by other people outside of the partner level? What sort of a ratio is there to that? So many of our metrics are pretty easy to do. You know, heck, accountants, right? We're accountants. We measure stuff. Well, where our accountants start getting a little bit flummoxed is when we're dealing with qualitative metrics. How do we track something like teamwork? I need somebody to be a better team player. Well, some of these things are obvious to a reasonable person who's just watching. And so if Judy comes to me and says, Dom, I need you to help me on this project, and I always say, yeah, I'll get to it, and I never help Judy, that's something that can be reasonably observed over a period of a week or two or three or four. And we can look and say, you know, Dom, it doesn't sound like you've been a good team player. Judy keeps asking you for help, and you just keep putting her off. And I said, well, yeah, I always help her. Well, no, let's take a look at where you have. And then we can take a look at other metrics to see, have I helped you or not? So those kinds of things. You know, some of the issues with people in our profession is not everybody's wired to be quite as self-aware as others. And so they may be a little more difficult to get along with than others. We we can watch for those kinds of behaviors. Or how about responsiveness to clients? You know, those are the kinds of things you can kind of poke around in emails and phone calls and try to figure out, did Dom get back with this client when he was supposed to? Is there a turnaround time that I'm meeting or not? Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Let me, before, you know, we, and I want to make sure, let's talk about the mentoring versus the coaching side. I know that I've had probably three really great mentors in my professional career. And I've usually sought them out. You know, you meet somebody and you go, boy, I would love to spend more time with that person. And when I've asked, it's kind of interesting. One person that I asked, when I called her to ask her if I could come visit her in her firm and pay her for her time for like 2 days and just hang with her and see what she does. You know, she was like, whoa, nobody's ever asked me that. Anyway, those mentors taught me different things than I learned within the firm. Do I have a responsibility to, because I had my own firm at the time, a small firm, but do I have a responsibility to share that I do have an outside mentor or what I'm learning from that outside mentor with the people, the partners, or my supervisor who I work for? You know, how do, what's the balance between that and how much information is optimal to share?
So do you have a responsibility to share within your firm, your bosses, that you've got an outside mentor? Mm-hmm. I don't know. That's a good question. You know, it's the kind of a thing that if you have a a reasonable working relationship there and good respect for you among the bosses, why wouldn't you share that you've got some high-powered person outside the firm mentoring you with that, right? You don't have to, I would imagine, but why wouldn't you? You know, many firms, as you mentioned that, Judy, that's a good point. Many firms bring in outside coaches or mentors or consultants to help high-level people, either high potentials to help them move up, or sometimes we've been brought in to help folks.
Let them down.
Not like you, but folks who were struggling. So when they bring us in, it's kind of like they're throwing everything at the problem they can to try to fix something, right? And everybody's leadership is aware of that too. But that's not uncommon for highly motivated, driven professionals to go and look for somebody outside the firm as a mentor. Now, that's not the most common mentorship that we see, partly because there's maybe not that many highly driven, self-motivated, results-oriented people that look and say, where do I need to go to get a little bit better help on this? You mm-hmm. know, because mm-hmm. in that respect, you were probably kind of the outlier in a good way.
Yeah, no, I understand what you're saying. Yeah, it was unusual at the time.
Well, and I think it's still somewhat unusual as we look at it in terms of external mentors and seeking them out. But that's also another, what you pointed out is another attribute of a mentor relationship is that the mentors are often sought out by the proteges. They look and they say, I want to know what she knows. I want to know what he knows. I want them to walk with me and show me what I need to do to be like them or to be mm-hmm. successful. Yeah, that's a good question. Good point.
Judy, do you have any final thoughts or questions for Dami as we near the end?
No, I mean, it's such a great topic, and it's so critical. It doesn't matter what size the firm is. It's a critical issue, because leaving people to be on their own and, you know, learn it through osmosis, you know, that kind of thing, it just doesn't work. And if we're willing to pay somebody, we ought to take responsibility to help nurture them. So I appreciate, you know, being able to talk about it with somebody like Dom, who has been doing this for a really long time, and helping firms create that process that you refer to, so that they can be successful at it. Because being bad, you know, having it not be successful is worse than not even doing it.
Yeah, agreed. I think now, since we have two major factors which are causing an inflection point, one is the time in which senior leadership of firms will be retiring. Added to that, when we get back to the so-called new normal, if you will, where remote operation of firms, where communications is going to be critical. And I think firms are going to start to look at how effective or not their coaching system is, or whether they need to establish one pronto. Final thoughts, Tommy?
I agree. And the remote workforce presents even more problems when it comes to coaching people, because you've got that, you just can't do the same thing on the screen as you can when you're in person with somebody. And that's gonna make coaching even more valuable and more necessary as you go forward with it.